Welcome to the show where we talk about real film movies, which are both the same thing, but we'll talk about the news and reviews and your views on film and TV and comic books too. We'd love to hear from you. We hope you enjoy it too. So subscribe to Real Film Podcasts and Review.
Hey everyone, welcome to the Real Film Podcast, in which we like to chat about the latest in film, TV, comics and gaming. I'm Rob and I'm here. Matt's here. And Hattie's here.
Hiya.
How's everyone?
Hi.
This is everyone. A new informal section at the beginning of the podcast.
What were we chat?
Just have a chat.
We keep about it real. What we're doing. Can we call it keeping it real?
Keeping it real.
Keeping it real.
We are now.
We are. Keeping it real.
Got some nice beers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are you drinking?
Whitstable Bay Pale Ale. It's very nice. Nice. Do you want to hear the description of the pale ale?
Go for it.
It's going to be pretentious.
Are we going to pretend that they sponsored us and they've sent us a crate?
Maybe they'll send us more.
A 4% pale ale. This is a contemporary beer inspired by the vibrant coastal town of Whitstable, which is renowned for its culture, seafood and beaches.
Ooh.
Not its beer.
Well, I like culture, beer. Seafood
feels
and beaches.
Feels weird to boast about.
Yeah.
A well-balanced beer has been crafted using aromatic Challenger and Styrian?
Can you read?
Goldings tops, which deliver a fruity, refreshing taste.
Is it refreshing?
It is.
It was mine's thirst quenching, apparently. It is.
That's good.
It has quenched my thirst. I can say
that's
that.
That's what you want from a drink, generally, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah, so if Masters Breweries want to send us more stuff.
Yeah, like some people might think this is a sponsorship
yeah, yeah.
section.
This isn't.
It's not.
It's
this
isn't a sponsorship.
This is
us
begging for.
Just give us beer
free
and we'll
beer.
Podcast.
We want free beer, that's what we want.
Yeah, don't go on Patreon. Just send us a crate of beer and we'll carry on podcasting because we'd just spend the money on beer anyway. So
exactly. It's all my money.
Cutting out the middleman.
That's why I'm poor.
Yeah.
You got.
Yeah, I've just got a Tisky.
No.
So I've gone boring for the lager.
Yeah, no pretentious.
1692
hipster
though.
Beers.
Yeah, not like
well,
us.
It's
nice
a hipster,
Polish.
It's a hipster lager.
It's not. It's a poor Polish. It's a poor that's, lager that they sell in.
That's the hipster
Polish
hipster,
news agents
it?
That you
yeah,
can
no,
buy for
exactly.
like a quid.
That's why
it's
hipster.
Nice though.
Is it hipster or is it what? Chow Street. It's nice, but
it's nice.
So you get Polish chavs drinking on the streets. So
well,
I mean,
it swings and roundabouts.
If you drink a lot of it, it messes you up. Someone told me.
What? In what way? Like intestinal?
No, that it can give you horrendous hangovers, apparently.
Oh, right.
Someone
right.
said that
I've
to me. That, no, but have you ever drunk loads of it?
Yeah.
Have you?
Friday night, man.
No, you don't. I've had about four cans and that's about it.
Well, some people might say that's a lot.
That's not a lot. It's an average Wednesday.
Breakfast.
Yeah, I'm making my cornflakes.
So I'm going to start with an agenda.
Oh.
New year, new podcast, new rules.
Hopefully people won't hate it.
Number one, which we've
no
already...
feminism.
Well,
that's not the agenda.
Can I make a motion?
One, it's the news. Talk about all the news. Two, we discuss trailer of the week. Three, we review what we've seen this week. Films and books,
yeah.
games,
TV.
Whatever, TV. Four, we chat about the BBC TV series Sherlock.
What,
in
every
the main
week,
segment.
Every week from
just
now
this,
on.
You know, there's a different agenda each week, man.
I know, but you made
Come
it
on.
Sound like every week we're going to talk about
well, maybe
Sherlock.
We will. Number five, we play the first ever box office quiz showdown game thing.
Ooh.
Six, Matt does the one-star Amazon review quiz.
If it's still on my laptop.
Seven.
I can find it.
We have question of the week.
Mm-hmm. Have we got a question?
Yes. Eight, is interesting facts of the week. Thought it'd be a little interesting thing to leave people on.
Does anybody have an interesting fact?
You
I do.
Oh,
okay.
On this.
Nine.
I have nothing to give to these things.
Is real issues. What are we pissed off about?
I know that one.
Ten is feedback, but we don't have any,
feedback.
So that
would just be
goodbye. Doesn't count. We need people to give us feedback for that
feedback
to, so that's
to
be
us.
A thing.
And not just, we liked your podcast. Just because that's...
Well, that will be better than nothing.
It will be better than nothing, but no one wants to hear us just... You know, blowing our own trumpets.
True.
We don't have any trumpets.
True to the news.
Yeah,
is that what we're starting
let's do the news. Number one, it's the news.
What's been going on in the news? What's been going on in the movie news? Well, that actor you like's done another thing. There's a few more reboots and a sequel too. And that other guy got caught with some cocaine. It's the news.
Shall I start? I've got my
mm-hmm.
news.
Three. No, I need to introduce the news first.
What do you mean you need to introduce the news?
There's
it's our news segment in which we can pick one and only one piece of news each to discuss because of the arbitrary rules that we set up.
Oh,
and then I've also written, I would like to start with a bit of disturbing news.
Oh, okay.
And that is that Patrick Stewart is going to be shit in the
this is my news. I'm going to have to find something else.
Literally and metaphorically and...
He's going to be the
shit in the new emoji movie.
He's
going to
be the poop.
He's the poo emoji.
I'm not sure whether it's like more upsetting that he is in the emoji movie or the fact that there is an emoji movie.
I've not watched the trailer.
Is there a trailer? Oh,
God. Well, no one's sure what it's going to be and what it's going to be about or what it's going to be like. No one knows what the style is and what it's... Like, is it emojis in real world?
It looks like... You can guarantee there's going to be like a aubergine penis joke.
That's all it's going to be.
With the little water things coming out. Yeah.
That's all.
And there's going to be the laughing
stood
face.
Next to each other, won't they?
The little laughing face that
with the tears.
Pisses me off. Yeah.
You don't like that.
It's the worst emoji. I just hate it. It's so sarcastic and like.
Laura uses it all the time.
I hate it so much.
Sarcastic. I don't understand.
No, but it's like smuggy, kind of like it's when someone like does something.
Being smug. I don't understand.
Yeah, but in a subtle way, not an obvious way. That makes you a dick. If you're subtle about it, you get away with it. Yeah.
Maybe it is good.
Patrick Stewart's. Literally, his shit filter is not worse than this one, is it?
Maybe
it's got a great script.
Yeah, maybe it does. Maybe it's going to be really funny.
Like the Lego movie, that was good.
Lego movie was very good.
Sausage Party, people weren't sure about.
Yeah, that was... Yeah.
I mean, that's just food in a supermarket.
Yeah, but it obviously wasn't a cash-in like the emoji movie.
No, that's true.
Yeah, probably
Angry Birds, I mean, did anyone see that?
Apparently that was all right, yeah.
Really?
For what it was.
But yeah, who's talking about it?
Well, yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that was my bit of news.
Good news.
Good news. Do you have any news, Hat?
Because
Rob's just stolen my news, so I'm still looking for something new.
There's something about... There's a film with dogs in. Wait.
Oh, yeah. A Dog's Purpose.
Yeah. And
it's to be beaten and abused and thrown into a swimming pool.
Yeah, there's all these like films of the dogs looking distressed, the stunt dogs.
Yeah, because they were basically just thrown into... there's a bit, I think, where it's to swim in and like pull this kid out of the water, and they were filming it, and... There's like a video come out of one of the stunt guys basically throwing this dog into the water to get it to go in, I think.
Poor
Which is kind of really worrying, because you think a film with that many dogs and about dogs, you'd think
it'd be dog people.
One, the people would like dogs that were making the film, and two, that the animal rights people would keep a proper close eye on a film with that many animals in it. Because obviously at the end, most of the films you'll see no animals were harmed in the making of this film or whatever.
This is like, we threw 20 dogs into a pool, 10 of them died.
Drowned.
Well, the thing is, you can not harm a dog physically, but still...
Emotionally.
Like, yeah, give it a bad time.
Inside.
Yeah.
Inside. Don't be mean to dogs.
Don't be mean to dogs. It's bad.
Moral of the week.
Yeah. So that's my news.
I think genuinely, though, that will actually really hurt that film.
Matt's just still talking about it. Yeah, I'm still he's just like, genuinely, though, I mean, don't hit your dogs.
Gotta keep saying words until... No, I think it will actually hit, because a lot of people were looking
forward
to it.
Hasn't it been... The premiere was stopped, wasn't it?
Probably, yeah.
I think it was.
I think people are going to boycott it.
Well, I think it's probably not going to get shown anywhere.
Yeah, which is kind of really hilarious, and serves them right. But I saw someone put it on
Facebook.
Then
the dog suffered for nothing, Matt.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but they shouldn't
put a
suffer
twist
for
it.
Well, for art. Suffer for art.
Maybe the dog wanted to suffer. Maybe it was like, throw me, I need to be throw in the moment.
In. Yeah,
you've
yeah.
Got, you've got to throw me in, because I've got to get into it.
Maybe it was
method. Maybe it's a method dog.
You never know.
Yeah, I don't know. It'll probably really mess it up and stuff. And who's there? There's a guy who does the voice in it. Of one of the dogs, I think, and I can't remember what his name is, but he's quite well known American comedian. No, and he wrote this big thing saying that I read the script, I thought it was great, saw other ideas, and they wanted me to do a voice, so I did it, thought it was amazing, and then this thing's come out now about this dog, and I've sent an email to the producers and then everyone asking for an explanation about what happened, because it's totally wrong, and I just want to let everyone know that I wouldn't have signed up for this project if I knew that this sort of thing was happening, and hopefully we'll get an answer about what was going on there.
Good stuff. Well, not really, but...
No, it's not good stuff, but interesting bit of news.
It is.
I don't know what this article is. Dwayne Johnson's Black Adam lands his own DC movie. Don't know how official this is.
Oh, because there's
just read the headline.
It's a Shazam movie, isn't it?
Yeah.
And Black Adam's like the...
Yeah. I don't know how much of this is... Do you want to cut this out if I... While I read it. Cut out the silence.
Cut out the awkward silence.
Before the first movie is even out, but when you've been a character, you can forgive one of the attempts to create an obscure museum, but if you is now split in its planned Shazam movie. Oh, okay. So the Shazam movie is going to be split into two, with one focusing on Johnson's anti-hero character, Black Adam. So there you go. That's my news.
I can't get excited about DC.
No, I can't
anymore.
No.
Just one. Did you hear the rumours about Wonder Woman being a mess as well?
Yeah, they've been going around for a
while. I mean, that's not surprising, is it? If it came out saying Wonder Woman's a perfectly well-scripted and edited together film, then you'd be like, wow, that's amazing.
No, then you'd be, I don't believe that.
DC have made a weird, decent film.
Have they done this? Have they done this right? Maybe.
I'm sure.
I don't know. Yeah. Who knows? I'm not really... I'll go and watch everything DC do, but I'm not looking forward to any of it, I won't say.
I kind of am, but in like...
To see how much of a car crash it is.
I am, because I'm a fan of the characters, and kind of like this hopeful optimism, like...
Yeah.
When United was playing under Louis van Gaal, sort of... You're kind of optimistic, and then you realize it's just shit.
It's got to get better at some point.
Horrible optimism. You can't help but feel, but you know it's going to be shit deep down.
But then it makes you hate it even more when it doesn't meet those expectations.
It does, but you can't help it.
That's true.
Can't help it.
Maybe we should just accept. Like with X Men, I've just accepted now that it's probably not going to be very good.
The last two, apart from Apocalypse, were really good.
Yeah.
I still kind of didn't have high expectations, so I wasn't.
Speaking of X-Men, shall we discuss the trailer of the week?
Oh, good segue, man.
Yes.
Yeah.
Totally planned it.
Go for it. Logan.
You shouldn't acknowledge a segue, by the way. It's really sad.
Shouldn't what?
Acknowledge a segue.
I didn't acknowledge it. She acknowledged it.
Yeah, guys, come on. I'm professional.
So sorry.
Professional podcasting.
We're not Logan. Professional until we get paid with free beer.
Free beer.
Master Brewers Collection. Yeah. Available at all good supermarkets.
Tesco, probably. Logan, trailer. Good.
Yeah. Lots of swears.
Lots of swears.
Patrick Stewart says fuck in it.
Mm.
He sounds Welsh though.
It's all that Alzheimer's.
I'm fucking 90. It sounds like kind of weird accent, but lots of X-23 in action.
She looks pretty sick.
Should I ruin it?
Ruin what?
Who X-23 is.
Everyone knows who X-23 is.
I don't know who X-23 is.
Oh, maybe don't ruin it then.
Don't ruin it then. She's got claws like Wolverine though.
She does.
Yeah.
And has similar mutant abilities.
Although she has two, I think, doesn't she?
Yeah, she does.
And he has three.
So she can flip him the bird.
Is she his kid?
No.
Is she his clone?
Good vibes.
I'm really looking forward to this one.
It's the same guy did the one in Japan,
the Wolverine,
isn't it?
The Wolverine. Which had some good stuff.
It had
some good stuff in it. It got a bit generic towards the end.
I just hope, Fox have learned a lesson from Deadpool.
Fox is idiots. They're not. They've just. What do you mean? Learned the lesson from Deadpool? They've literally just got.
They've literally just got
Golden Globe nominations for Deadpool. They've been hugely praised for Deadpool.
Yeah, I know, but
they probably don't feel like they've got to learn a lesson from Deadpool.
What I mean. Yeah, that's what I mean. I'm saying learn a lesson by not interfering in the film.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Because Deadpool was the best, probably one of the most enjoyable films.
Yeah.
That Fox or particularly X-Men have put out in the last few years.
Yeah.
And that's largely because it was a passion project from Ryan Reynolds. Yeah. So you kind of hope they've learned from that and just said, you go and make whatever film you want to make. And it looks like they kind of have because there's a lot of swears, a lot of violence.
A lot of swears and violence and
the
stabbing.
Last of His vibe. Yeah. Shot of the guy with Nail and I.
The guy.
With Nail and I.
The guy from With Nail and I.
Monty.
No.
He died.
No, the other guy. The main
Monty,
guy.
Monty, you terrible.
The main guy.
The main guy,
Richard E. Grant.
Oh,
yeah, shot of him.
God, that took a while, didn't it?
Well, if you just he's in that film.
Yeah, shot of him. Not really. He's kind of far away, isn't it? It's not a very good shot of him. So
he looks good.
Do you know who he's playing yet? Is he playing
playing
scientist-y?
Yeah, person? I do know. It's a guy who's teased at the end of.
He's not guaranteed though. It's not like confirmed, is it? I think it's all rumored who he's playing.
What was the tease at the end of Apocalypse? I can't remember.
It's a Weapon X thing. Cause it says like. What's his name? The guy, the villain. The villain, I can't remember his name, but he's teased at the end of Apocalypse and it's him who's Richard E. Grant's playing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can't confirm, Rob.
Allegedly,
he's doing that. I'm really looking forward to this film.
I thought the first trailer was better.
Oh, yeah,
the first trailer was just really cool.
Yeah.
And it was,
I think that one's very atmospheric. This was a bit more his kind of plot.
What's about. I don't like plot trailers. They're just irritating.
No, I think you've got to, though, haven't you? Otherwise. Like, unless you're invested in it straight away, people aren't going to come and watch it. They're just going to go, I don't really know what that's about, so I don't want to go and watch that. Whereas, obviously, as an X-Men fan, you kind of watch it and go, oh, I know what this is about. It's about, there's not many mutants anymore. Logan's one of the only ones around. He's looking after Professor X. He comes across X-23. They're obviously getting chased because someone wants X-23, but as someone that probably doesn't know anything, you'd kind of just... go, what was that? What's going on?
Yeah.
It's not running about. So you kind of need a plot trailer every now and again.
But it looks good.
It looks good. I'm looking forward to it.
Shall we talk about what we've seen this week?
Yeah, I've seen
what
loads.
What we've done, have you?
Yeah.
Do you want to start then?
I've seen some things. I've watched a lot of TV and seen a film.
Guess who went to the cinema this week? We saw some films and we watched some Netflix. Listen up to our ill-informed opinions and then go and see it all anyway. Because who knows, not us, but we'll rate it anyway.
Go on, Em.
What shall I start with, TV or film?
Whatever you want.
I'll start with film. I went to watch Passengers because I was bored. And I sat around at home and I can get free tickets. And I thought, what's on now that I've not
seen?
I've
got no friends to go to do stuff with.
Everyone's busy. It was just like, Passengers was on.
That one person.
Yeah. So I went to watch Passengers.
You went on your own to watch Passengers?
Yeah.
Bet that was awkward.
Yeah, it's all
right. You're like a creepy guy in the back.
I was sat in the background, yeah. Because everyone else was like sat kind of in positions where I'd be sat too close to them if I sat anywhere near them. So I was like, oh, I'll go in the back corner and just stay away from everybody. It was all right. Was average. Could have been better.
Just like all the reviews from...
I think people have hated on it more than they kind of should. But I think it's because it could have been a lot better. It could have had really interesting, you know, plot turns, but it just kind of go quite generic and it doesn't push it as far as it could have done with the whole fact that Chris Pratt's character's awake on the spaceship for a year on his own. And it sort of glosses over that a bit. They kind of give him long hair and a beard to make it look like, oh, look, he's going... A bit crazy, and the stuff that Chris Pratt's given, he is quite good at, kind of him being, losing his mind a little bit because he's really lonely, but they kind of rush over that because they kind of think, oh, we need to get Jennifer Lawrence and Chris Pratt on screen together as soon as possible, so let's race through it a little bit. But some good stuff, now it's Jennifer Lawrence and Chris Pratt, obviously two quite likeable people, they have a good dynamic together. Yeah, it's kind of tense towards the end.
Sounds like you've not got an awful lot to say about it.
No, I kind of have, but you kind of end up spoiling loads of it if you kind of talk about it too much. But it's got some good, you know, tense stuff towards the end. There's quite a few plot holes that you just think, obviously the spaceship's breaking down and there isn't a safety feature to wake up the crew so that they can fix the ship, which just seems really stupid for the whole film. But yeah, no, it's all right. If you're
fine,
I think people will like the average person. I think who isn't that into films will like that film because they'll just go and it's got a bit of tension. It's got a good core relationship,
sexy leads,
sexy people in the lead, and
making out.
You know, it has a happy ending. So I think people will. It's one for the masses, really. But don't go expecting.
One for the drones.
Yeah, I think I kind of enjoyed it a little bit just because I wasn't expecting anything of any higher caliber. I think because when I first...
I thought it was going to be shit. And it was all right.
Well, no, that's kind of it. I think when I first heard the premise, I was kind of going, oh, that could be really interesting. I think if I'd gone in on the back of just hearing the premise, I would have been disappointed because it doesn't really push any of the boundaries that it could do. But because I had low expectations, I was just thought, oh, yeah, cool. The wait's past an hour and a half, so it's all right. But I have been watching something that's a lot better, which is The Crown on Netflix, won... Golden Globe.
We talked about it last week, Matt, and you said you were going to watch it.
And I have. I'm on the last episode.
One of your words.
How are you going with The Martian?
Oh, I'm halfway through it now. I'm getting 220 pages in. Actually, it's fair. Bring up The Martian. The Passengers could have been The Martian. It could have been that good. It could have been that emotional and that funny, but it wasn't.
But they went for the creepy stalker.
No, it wasn't even that. It just didn't have the charisma that... Which is kind of strange thing, saying that Chris Pratt and Jennifer Lawrence are in it. It didn't have the charisma that Matt Damon had in that film. And the acting chops. I think he's a lot much better actor than Chris Pratt is, to be fair. But I don't think Chris Pratt's given a lot in this film.
Chris Pratt kind of does what he does well.
Yeah, so. He wasn't given a lot in this film. But yeah, The Crown's really good, actually. I'm really enjoying it. Get to see Matt Smith racing it up as Prince Philip, you know, being a bit racist to people. Actually, not racist, just culturally insensitive. There's a really funny, because there's a bit where they fly on this Commonwealth tour quite near the beginning, and I think they're in Kenya, and I was kind of sat there going, I'm kind of enjoying this, it's really well made, but are they just going to completely glorify the monarchy and just gloss over the fact that that these Kenyan people probably aren't actually that keen that we're there and stuff, and there's this Kenyan tribe king thing and he's got this massive headdress on And Philip goes up to him and goes, I like your hat. And then, you know, the Queen's like, it's a crown, it's not a hat. And he's like, oh. You kind of get that sense that it isn't all. I mean, it obviously it is not glorifying, but it does show the most of the character, especially the Queen, in a good light.
It always annoys me when people are too offended to kind of offend.
Yeah, no, I think they do a little bit. Like, there are complex characters, and like they with like Elizabeth and Prince and Philip's relationship, they don't actually hold back with getting them arguing and like the troubles that they had at the beginning of their marriage and everything. So it kind of does delve into some. I mean, there's only so far you can go, obviously, with something like that. Otherwise, it just wouldn't get made. But it is really, really well made. I'm really enjoying it. But I'm on like the last episode, and I don't know what is going to be, how this is going to end. Because obviously she's still on the throne 70 years later after this, and they're still
together. It's like a Tarantino style ending where she just gets assassinated.
Yeah. Just, but I don't because it's been telling all these stories, but obviously it's just the story of their lives, which, as I say, go on for the next 50, 60, 70 years. So I don't know what
unlimited seasons.
Yeah, it kind of hasn't had like an arc. It's been really enjoyable. There's like, I can't see what point it's going to finish at, when it's going to just go, okay, this is the end of the series now. But it's been really good, yeah. I've really enjoyed that. So if anyone's got Netflix, then you should check that out.
Good stuff.
I did also watch the first episode of Atlanta as well.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Is it good?
Yeah, it seems quite good.
What's it on? Fox?
It's on Virgin Fox. Yeah, you can. We've got it on Virgin. The Fox is on demand.
Steal Mum's Fox.
Yeah, it's on Virgin. Comes to our Virgin thing. So yeah, it's on there. Watch the first episode. Seems pretty good. It's not as funny as I thought so far. It's kind of more. It's not laugh out loud funny. It's more. Funny. at the moment, anyway, it might get funny, but it does seem quite good and quite well made. So I'm looking forward to getting a bit more into.
What else did you just watch before this podcast?
Oh, Pop Star, Never Stopping. That was really good. I really enjoyed that.
How that's not above Deadpool and the Golden Globes.
Oh, yeah, it was hilarious. Yeah. It's so funny and so clever.
Yeah.
It's like the subtle political.
Yeah.
Like the political joke about Finest Girl song is about him having sex with a girl who's.
Same.
Who finds like the assassination of Bin Laden like.
Sexy.
Arousing. Yeah. Which is like a whole metaphor for America's like glorification of their military war. And war and killing Bin Laden and illegal invasions of Iraq and.
And
people would think, like, I wonder how many people that didn't like this film. Do they just not get these references of?
Yeah, it's like you're saying as well. There's a bit where he goes for a poo in the Anne Frank house, and he comes out going, "Oh, don't go in there for a while, guys." And people probably took that as that's a poo joke. It's like, no, it's a joke on the fact that Justin Bieber wrote in the Anne Frank memorial book, "I hope that she would have been a believer." So that's what that's making a joke about.
Yeah,
it's not the fact that he's had a poo. It's just kind of gone, well, we'll take that disrespectful thought and just exaggerate it. So what's kind of really funny that he's kind of exaggerating that disrespectful thing? Oh, what if he took a poo in the toilet?
Yeah.
You just think.
It's really
if it had been a poo joke, he would have taken a poo and smeared it on the walls or something and been like, oh, look at this poo. Or he would have like, do you mean you don't see the poo?
Most of the jokes in that film are based on arse.
Yeah.
It's satire. Although there are no animals.
No, there isn't. According to Stuart Lee, that's
so
not satire.
So can it not be satire?
There's a turtle.
Oh, there is a turtle, yeah.
So it's satire.
Can't
be satire without. According to Stuart Lee, satire is just, like, Planet of the Apes is satire because it's animals, in place of humans.
Animal Farm, satire.
Satire.
Those are the only pieces of satire.
That's it, two things.
Two things.
They didn't get a lot of. I know that
critics
realised it got a crap release, but like, go and check it out.
It got a crap release here because it bombed America, right?
But I think because it's taking the piss out of America.
Yeah,
it's too clever. Yeah. America fucking just elected Trump president. Yeah. They're not going to like something that takes the piss out of America.
I feel like it's a lot more English comedy. I think it's a lot more of an English.
By that you mean it's much funnier.
Yeah,
it's much cleverer, more intelligent.
It's clever and deeper.
Maybe Andy Samberg if you don't want him.
Yes, please.
We will have him.
Yeah.
Maybe it would have been better if. All the jokes have just been generic poo jokes.
Probably
like Deadpool.
Deadpool, which is all about poo and dick jokes.
Yeah, exactly.
Anyway,
what have you guys watched? Seen anything?
We've been watching more Rick and Morty.
Rick and Morty,
which we've nearly finished now. That's really clever as well.
It's so good.
It's really clever.
It's so funny.
Funny. It's parts of it kind of satire and kind of.
Has it got animals in it?
Well, it's got aliens. I guess that
instead of animals, Rob.
We're all animals, really.
Hashtag deep.
Yeah.
Therefore, everything is satire.
Everything's satire. Yeah. Even this is satire right now.
Because yeah, there's animals in it.
Because there's animals
in
it.
What else have we watched? Oh, we went to see a Monster Calls.
We went to see a Monster Calls. You cried.
I cried.
Very sad film.
I didn't cry like
I almost recommended this to someone at work.
How did you not cry embarrassingly? Laura did. She had to redo her makeup after she'd seen
You were
it.
Kind of like... But I almost recommended this to a person at work who has two sons. I was like, don't.
Don't.
I very nearly sort of said, your kids really like... No, that's...
Do you think
that'd be a terrible thing to recommend to watch with someone's mum?
I think that's kind of the problem with this film, though, that the way it's been marketed, that it seems like a kid's film.
Yeah.
And I think
I think it is.
I think in respect, but I think... Like, it could go way over a kid's head, because, you know, unless, like... It's hard as a kid to kind of comprehend that kind of level of.
I think it does that quite well, though. It just kind of. I think it does explain it quite well.
I think it does.
Probably.
But I think
would be able to.
You would be able to take a young kid.
No, they're about the same age as the kid in the film.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was like, that's probably I didn't actually say it, but I did think about recommending it. I thought that'd be horrible.
There were parts though where I felt like this is a bit slow for me. Like, I feel like this is being explained a little bit too much for me. And
I thought some of the stories.
I think you have to a little bit,
but then, I felt like, well, that's, you know, it's not just for me. Because I
was sat there at times sometimes thinking, like, I get 5 stars on the website. And at times I was thinking, oh, yes, it's been explained a little bit too much. But, like, the end just completely, like, the emotion
the
just
incredible.
Blew me
it was,
away.
I wasn't expecting that at all.
I was just thinking, I'll forgive it for...
Yeah, yeah, that's
I liked
true.
The monster as well, that he wasn't... Like a big friendly giant who
Well, that was it, isn't it? It's like a metaphor of this whole rage inside of him sort of thing.
Mm.
Did you see the Liam Neeson Easter egg?
Yeah.
Spoiler alert for it. Yeah, that it's his granddad.
Too late.
Yeah, I thought that was really cool.
That was really cool.
I really liked him looking through the sketchbook as well.
At the end.
I really liked that. I really thought that was a really nice idea.
Because there's so many different ways you
could read
that.
I really like that it could have been like, it's his perception of his granddad from his mum.
Yeah.
Because
I kind of saw it as...
He knows about his granddad from his mum.
Yeah, because that's why I think that the story is that... Do you know that the monster tells him?
Mm.
I kind of interpret it of their stories that his granddad told his mum,
and then
she passed them on to him, and so that's kind of a really cool. Because do you find it not uplifting, but like at the end? Because I kind of
in
thought,
a way
because I kind of took it as things are crap now, but it's going
to
get better.
Okay,
that's how I took it at the end.
And his relationship with his grandma as well was really cleverly done. Like, you could see that she wasn't just being a dick for the sake of it. Like, she was trying to be realistic about everything.
I wrote this in my review that it's easy to kind of dislike her character at the start because she's very much, don't put your bag there, don't
she's
touch
like
it,
Dursley's,
do
isn't
this.
She?
Yeah, she's kind of like that, but then you think, well, you've got to remember, his mum's dying, but it's
her daughter
as well
dying
well before.
I wonder which one's more difficult.
Yeah, that's why it was kind of nice.
Because you never expect your daughter to die, do you? But you kind of know your mum's always going to die before you.
Yeah.
If things go to plan.
What with your merv? Yeah. Just unplugging the life of support.
But then that scene when he's destroyed her living room and she comes in, that was so, like, I relate to that quite a lot.
Yeah. I was very angry. I'm still
I really related
person,
to her reaction to it, whereas he probably reacted to him.
Oh, I reacted to him just being, because, the amount of times I felt like doing
it. It was actually because everyone gasped in our cinema, actually, when...
I love
when it found out, because you just thought, oh, it's all in his head.
I kind of knew.
And then, I kind of knew. But then when it cut to the full smashed up thing, everyone's like...
You know what, though? I have this thing about things that are irreplaceable being lost. I don't know whether
it's
I lost
sad.
Something.
It's sad,
so materialistic.
I find it so upsetting.
I found it more sad that his mum died, to be honest.
No, but even the day after, I was thinking, that grandfather clock was her mother's.
Yeah, I think the grandfather clock.
But that woman was his mother.
No, but things last a long
adopted,
time.
Get a new one. Get a new mum.
I don't know why. Because it's not like I have any heirlooms of my own. Yeah. But
you're
I
not
feel
exactly
like
a materialistic person either,
no,
are
but
you?
I feel like if something's
just
got
that fucking
that much
clock.
Emotion attached to it, to have it destroyed, I could...
Yeah. Like your mum.
Yeah, I found that really upsetting.
Like your mum. I mean, it was just like if your mum died, it'd be the same, wouldn't it?
Shut up. No, I feel like that really stayed.
It was the line that really got me when obviously the monster's saying, you've got to tell the truth. And you're kind of going... Well, what's he going to say? Like, what is this?
I'm sad.
Yeah, and then
well,
I'm just thinking,
well,
what's he going to say?
Like,
and then
she's going to die. Like,
yeah. Full spoilers, by the way.
Acknowledging,
spoilers.
Like, I know that she's going to die.
But
he
already knows that, so you kind of go, where's this going to go? And then he just yells, like, I want it to be over. Oh, and you just think,
I let her go, yeah. In the dream,
yeah, I let her go. Like, I want her to die so that it's all over.
The pain's gone.
And you just think that's... Yeah, that's no, like the such
last, last half hour of that film is incredible.
Yeah. Such like a real like emotion sort of thing that... And that kid's just like Howie's he's, not been nominated.
Yeah,
no, he's amazing. Like Howie,
kid actors don't generally tend to get.
But
like,
no, they should have a child.
Like really young ones do. Do you know if they're like six and have done an amazing performance, they get nominated for stuff?
I wonder if it's easier for your kids sometimes if you're.
But I just think that kid,
you're just sort of imagining, aren't you? You're just sort of you're not thinking, overthinking.
And you've got less of an ego to stroke.
Yeah. What else have we been doing?
What else did we watch? Watching.
I don't know. I finished Bryan Cranston's autobiography, which is very interesting. Really interesting. It's like
the start's incredible, isn't it? I read the start.
Oh God,
it's
that little first chapter. That's first page.
It's not like it is chronological, but it's each thing's like a different moment rather than a whole story.
I like that though, because it's like a different moment. Oh yeah, I went on holiday this time, and this is where this happened.
Yeah, I'm not usually into autobiographies, but I thought this one's because Bryan Cranston seems like a really interesting guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, really interesting actually. Really good insight into him as a. Like, he comes across as, like, a very serious actor as well, but not like a Matthew McConaughey.
The rabbit's outside. Yeah. The rabbit. It's there.
Is that one of ours?
Yeah. I believe.
Holy shit.
I just saw it walk past.
You will now continue with your regular.
Yeah, don't put that beer away.
It's hallucinating.
I thought
calm
it was
down.
It looked exactly like
I stopped the
audio.
Recording as well. I should have going because I thought it would be gone for, like, an hour. But...
rabbit. I'm sorry.
What were we talking about?
Bryan Cranston's autobiography is good.
Yeah.
Read it. I need a new book to read now.
I've got loads. Do you want some?
No, I've got shitloads.
I'm reading three currently.
Actually, that's just too many, you might say.
Well, I've got loads of stuff that I'm going to be doing.
What are you going to be doing?
Well, what do we know?
Oh, some more to talk about.
We've got more to talk about.
I feel like I have.
Live by Night? Have you spoken about that already?
Yeah, we spoke about that.
We watched another film this week, didn't
we? Watched La La Land and...
yeah, I did that.
Did that Manchester by the
Manchester
Sea.
Manchester by the Sea. Oh, I cried so much more at Manchester by the Sea. Because it's you.
It's me.
It's you going through awful things.
They just make you think about what it would be like for a went through awful things.
Yeah. It was horrible. But very, very good.
I'd become a janitor.
You'd become a janitor and you'd hate everything.
It's kind of...
You hate anything.
I hate everything. Yeah,
right. We've spoken about that.
Yeah. There's something else that I saw.
If we have kids, you're not allowed to...
I saw Gone Baby Gone. Did I talk about that?
No, because you watched it after we recorded. Oh, yeah.
That was good. That was good. Ben Affleck's first film. That's pretty good.
I only watched like the first 10 minutes and then you watched the rest without me.
And I watched Hail Caesar again. Very good film.
Oh yeah, I watched that. Yeah.
That's it.
Oh, we watched Hateful Eight again last night.
Fell asleep three times.
I still need to watch that.
I can't.
Properly.
It's too slow.
It is quite
slow. It's well made, it's great, but it's too slow.
You should watch it on double time.
Beautifully shot and like great dialogue.
Do you like those, like double? Yeah, put it on like double time, do you know, when you can still hear the dialogue.
Yeah, but it's just like slightly higher pitched.
Yeah, 1.5 times.
Yeah, maybe that'd
should play it on like that, yeah.
Should we move on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're going to talk, main topic, about BBC's TV series Sherlock. That's just finished its fourth season.
It's got a great theme
tune. I'm not putting in theme tunes.
The theme tune's so good. I love the theme tune. It's so good.
So fourth season just finished.
General thoughts on Sherlock as a whole.
All right, taking over. Yeah. You're driving this bus now, are you?
Yeah, I'm 3/4 of the way through this beer and
generally,
I'm stamping my authority all over this.
I really like it.
I love it.
I know a lot of people, particularly recently, I've seen a lot of people saying it's so far up its own arse. Mainly the Guardian call it like...
Oh yeah, because the Guardian's not up its own arse at all.
Well, exactly, yeah. And people going, this show is so far up its own, like in an... People up their own arse saying this show is up their own arse sort of
like
way.
Pot, kettle, it's like, blacks.
It's, and we've just watched like the first series and it's very up its own arse from the very first episode.
But that's the kind of point, isn't it?
That's kind of the point. Sherlock is up his own arse. Yeah.
That's literally the character. I think we watched it before it was cool.
I mean, I think we've 8.7 million viewers.
No, but I think that's
the first episode.
Yeah, it's a lot of viewers, but I think people didn't really start talking about it until season two, did they?
Oh, it did go up to 10 million.
Exactly, so.
And then 12?
Yeah. I think when the first season came out,
the last episode of season four got 6.
It really dropped off the end of last season.
Really,
I suppose we'll talk about that in a bit. But I remember watching the first season, people didn't start raving about it until like season two, really, but. Because obviously, like, Benedict Cumberbatch was a bit of a nobody. Martin
no one could say his name.
Yeah, yeah. But he was who's this funny-looking guy?
Cheekbones.
Yeah.
Looks like an
and now people act like he's Ryan Gosling. He's no Ryan Gosling.
He's a very charming man.
He is charming. No, he's a really nice guy. I really, really like Benedict Cumberbatch. But and Martin Freeman had done The Office and Love Actually and maybe Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Yeah. But he wasn't huge, was he? So
best actor Ian McKellen's ever worked with, apparently.
Oh, Marty Freeman's incredible.
Yeah, he's one of my favourites.
I think, because
if you watch his mannerisms, like the way he moves his hands and his face and his...
You just believe that he's a real person. Yeah.
In any, everything that he does.
He's not acting. Yeah, he's not acting, is he?
He's just responding.
I'll take a minute and do full Sherlock spoilers.
Full spoilers. Marty Freeman dies.
Like the scene where you think Sherlock's dead and he's at the graveside, like Martin Freeman's performance there is just unreal. You just think, yeah, that's kind of how people... Do you know people don't sit down by a graveside and pour their heart out? If they talk, yeah, that's kind of how they talk. They kind of feel a bit stupid and a bit awkward because they're thinking, I'm just talking to like...
Does he cry? I can't remember that bit.
He's half crying. Yeah. He's like fighting back tears and stuff.
Oh, I probably cried then.
But Martin Freeman's just... awesome.
Martin Freeman makes you cry in The Hobbit.
It's all in the face.
Yeah, it's all in the face.
Martin Freeman's like carries those Hobbit films.
Yeah. He's one of my favourite actors.
If he wasn't in The Hobbit, I would not watch those films again.
No.
I think I watched them just for him.
I think he's one of those underrated actors around.
Yeah. He never has
like the big parts. Yeah, it's like playing a Hobbit's not...
It's not, yeah.
I know he's the Hobbit in The Hobbit.
It's very much an ensemble cast, isn't it?
Well, he's the main role in it, but he's still not thinking of it as a big part because he's not a big character.
Yeah. Mm. He is awesome. And he's awesome in Sherlock.
But then he's often cast as like the everyman. He's like person that you insert yourself into as the audience.
Maybe
he needs more to do.
I'll give him more to do. I'm writing a film at the minute.
But he's quite a short guy, isn't he? He's not
particularly
You think about leading men. You think
Tom
like
Tom Cruise is pretty short.
Tom Cruise is a fucking psychopath.
Well, yeah, exactly. Why isn't Martin Freeman?
Well, but Tom Cruise is very like traditionally quite handsome and charming and American.
I think Freeman's a good looking man.
He is, but he's not like he's not got that.
It's a silver fake, fox.
He's not got that fake American charisma.
Got a very. But English if you look charisma. At
like leading men like Ryan Gosling, Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, even Benedict Cumberbatch is kind of.
They've got.
I know a lot. He has a presence, which Martin Freeman doesn't quite have. Is what I'm saying.
He's great, though.
I think he's a better actor than probably.
Yeah. Than.
I want to see him do more.
Get him an Oscar.
Well, that's it. I'm writing a film at the moment, and Martin Freeman.
Martin
Freeman, Andy Serkis, in The Hobbit was so good.
Two incredible actors. Two of the most underrated actors out there.
Yeah.
Go back to Sherlock.
Is Sherlock clever?
I think it was cleverer. I think it has tried to get a bit too convoluted now for the sake of being convoluted.
I think that's the point, though, isn't it? It's kind of the show that you have to keep one up in yourself. I think it's trying to escalate each year, isn't it? You know, they started off, like the first two seasons were incredible and they did have a great,
fantastic
progression. And then you have Moriarty in the end of season two, and all that was
and
just
season one Moriarty.
Season. Yeah, and to, I mean, and but and end of season two is where he dies. And
but yeah, the you end just of have... season two was such a natural end to things. It felt like that was tying up all the threads that had been unraveled.
It was just
in the
such a
few.
Huge thing, and then you go, well, how do you?
But what was one? Yeah, that? What was great about the first two series as well is you had individual episodes, and then you realise they're all kind of linked to Moriarty, like afterwards.
Not
as like an afterthought, but kind of. The individual cases that make, and Sherlock has to work through the individual cases.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you've got, and each episode was kind of like that. And then you get to series three and you've got kind of the one where Sherlock comes back to life. And I can't remember what the mystery is in that one.
Because yeah. Marty Freeman ends up at the bottom of a bonfire, doesn't he?
Oh, it's the and first have, one of, yeah,
and
it's
they
the first
to go
one.
And
with,
find him, don't they? The first one with Magnuson.
Yeah. Is that his name? What was Benny Charles Magnuson. Returns? Christmas special in season three. I don't think I saw that.
What did it say?
Oh, it's all of the theories about how.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's not actually a thing. It's just like.
Oh yeah, because he's met Molly, hasn't he? Mary.
Yes.
John has met Mary in between.
Yeah. So there.
Is that great?
When he has
Okay, so that's the start. Yeah. Of
Which is great,
Magnuson, isn't it?
Yeah, Magnuson, but that is great. I think Sherlock coming back and everything, and I think that episode can rely on that.
I think like series three relied on kind of the characters rather than the any story. Sort of mystery.
Yeah.
Like, there's a wedding episode, obviously, then, which is Sherlock. Like, Benedict Cumberbatch is really, really
That's good a really episode. Entertaining episode.
I really like that episode. A lot of people didn't like it because there's not... The mystery's a bit shit in it.
Yeah. But you just go, it's a really then, entertaining episode.
The end of series three was the one with, like, the whole Mind Palace stuff.
Yeah.
Which and is, he was, like, he hidden... Magnussen hid... He, I thought he was really good. It's Mads Mikkelsen's brother,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, it is, yeah, yeah.
And he's, like, hidden... piece of information, is it? Oh, he's got information on everyone, but it's
on,
in,
but
it's
on everyone, on but everyone. Specifically Mary Watson.
Yeah, like, this, but he thinks they've hidden it somewhere, but actually it's all in his mind palace.
And I kind of think it's a cool concept, but I think that sort of, you know, higher level of photographic memory is so much beyond, do you know, like what normal people can do. It is, like, I'm sure people do have techniques like that, and it is thing, but I think most people just think, well, I can't remember where I left my keys. So it kind of feels a bit above, like, you know, like the everyman, it isn't very relatable. Yeah. And you just go, I'm not really buying into this. But I did like the end to that series.
I really loved that last episode.
You know, the only way... when he kills him, you just think, like... And you think the progression from series one, where he had no friends and everything, now he's willing to...
Kill people
to save John and make him happy and everything. You just think that's incredible.
That obviously ended with the Moriarty return...
Yeah,
which was not answered for a long time.
No, but...
And still not really answered.
Well it was. It was all just a plan of Euros, wasn't it?
But was... Against that. So we had the Abominable Bride, which was the one which was...
That was the Christmas one.
Victorian-themed.
Yeah. That was just... That was a bit weird. Loads of people had a problem with that, but I just thought... It was just a bit of fun.
It's
like
just a Christmas
filler.
Special.
Yeah.
It's like the other Christmas special was just all the theories of how he'd come back from the dead... by people thinking that he must still
wasn't
be alive.
Wasn't that in the actual episode?
No, that was the Christmas was it? Series.
Okay. I think there was
I can't
couple.
Remember at all.
Yeah, there may be a couple. Because he explains it, doesn't he?
He doesn't. He gives, like, multiple explanations.
Yeah, exactly. But you don't think any of them are real.
No.
Because
yeah,
so you kind really of, like... It. I think that's nicer that they... Because at first, I was if they don't explain it, I'm going to be really, really annoyed. But I thought, actually,
if they explain
it, I'm
going to be
disappointed. So I think it's better that there's this sort of mystery about how he faked his death and everything. I don't mind that.
And then we've just finished Series 4.
Yeah.
Which, not, in my opinion, probably...
Not as good. Worst season so far, I'd say.
Yeah.
I think. I'd say on par with 3. I'd prefer 1, 2.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, 1 and 2. Still better than most things out there.
And that's the thing. I still... It is.
It's still enjoyable. It's still captivating.
A lot of comments saying this is a pile of shit. It's garbage. Mark Gatiss is up his arse. Mark Gatiss needs to quit. He's ruining it like he ruined Doctor Who.
He was in it quite a lot this series.
Not Mark Gatiss. Stephen Moffat, sorry.
Well,
both
Mark
of them.
Gatiss,
I quite like Mark Gatiss. I really like the characters. I really like the scene with him and John where he's trying to convince Sherlock to kill him.
Oh, that was incredible.
That was really good.
I mean, I saw what was happening straight away.
Yeah, I called it. And I was like, actually, I kind of did. And I was like, oh, is he actually? He's a bit of a dick.
Yeah. I like that though.
But we had a Six Thatchers, which kind of didn't make an awful lot of sense to me. Where the guy had hidden his USB stick in a statue.
Oh yeah, yeah.
But like, how did that not fall out of the bottom of the statue or anything?
Yeah, I didn't really get that.
Yeah,
it's
a bit.
It was a bit tenuous. I mean,
I think that's where it's getting.
And
out,
it kind of had too much with Marion recently as well. I was like, I don't really. She's the character I care least about in this whole story.
I wish that Mary had been done differently.
I think she was done quite well. I just didn't really. That's not. She's not the
I
main
really
focus.
I didn't like her being an assassin. I didn't really like her backstory, like jumping in when it's convenient. Like, she should have a backstory that ended. But then that's a problem I think that this has.
Yeah, I liked the idea that she had this backstory and everything. That she wasn't who she said she was. I actually quite liked that, but I didn't kind of. You know, I think once that was ended and John went, I don't care who you are now. You're Mary Watson. That's why I care
that's
about.
That's when it should have finished.
That's
I was
finished,
like, that,
yeah.
I don't want to know about her past because I kind of don't find her very... when we actually saw her being an assassin and stuff in this episode,
I don't really buy her being
an assassin. But being told that she was, I just go, okay, that was her past. But seeing it kind of is another thing. I don't think they needed to expand on that story anymore and... I mean,
it did get quite convoluted as well. Just
the fact, the fact that
she kept saying, "Oh, I'm here now," and then I'm not here, and then she's back.
It was this kind of weird thing that
gets shot at the end.
That that it was the receptionist or whatever at the end of this episode, was it? That done all the stuff.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that. Yeah,
and you just think, why
there wasn't
why
same kind
that?
Of conviction of the first two episodes, which were like, "There's a taxi driver, really clever.
He's
hardly in it, but he's a really memorable."
She literally is in it. Once.
I can't picture her face.
No, I can. I can vaguely, and she's in it in one scene earlier.
No payoff. That's my issue with I think all these episodes, apart from the last one, maybe.
Yeah,
but there's no kind of payoff in any, or the end of each episode doesn't really kind of have any impact. Like the end of this, the first one, John blames Sherlock for Mary dying.
Yeah.
And then that doesn't really, like, why is he blaming her for one?
Yeah.
Doesn't really make an awful lot of sense. Because she's an assassin and like that, she makes her own decisions. Exactly, like, yeah. I find that's quite offensive that to assume that he's just used her as a pawn or something when he clearly hasn't. Anyone rational can see that. And John Watson is supposed to be quite a rational man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then that's kind of instantly forgot about in the next episode or very quickly forgot about. And then the end of episode two, Euros shoots John with what is quite obviously a normal looking gun.
Yeah.
It's a tranquilizer. Like, oh, it's a tranquilizer. That's it. And that's the whole
thing. Yeah, like, that's the problem.
But it does ruin it when they do a cliffhanger and then 30 seconds later show a trailer of the next episode with John Watson alive.
I was literally just about to say that.
Why are you doing a cliffhanger? We know he's not dead. What is the point?
We know
that. Or at least.
Don't show the trailer afterwards.
Or at least show us how he gets out of that situation.
Yeah.
Yeah, or just don't pretend to kill him because obviously.
No, but don't pretend to kill him, but maybe have a gun to his head at the end and then leave it as a cliffhanger because then there's a way. Then at the end, we're like, oh, how does he get out? How does he get out of it? Don't just then ignore the situation and say, oh, it's a tranquilizer, that was it. And then it's like the whole cliffhanger was totally meaningless.
Yeah, it's pointless. It's kind of like,
that was really bad writing.
I can see why it trailed off there. Yeah. Went from 9.5 to 9.9.
Like, it was almost like clickbait sort of thing, isn't it? That sort of misleading cliffhanger and stuff.
But I did like the episode as a whole, the second one. With
apart
from the Mary kind of, again, the weird DVD that she left, we just kept having different notes on it. It was just, but the... Toby Jones?
Oh, yeah.
Is that his name?
Yeah.
I think so.
As Jimmy Savile.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was
It wasn't a very subtle...
Oh, I don't think it has to be, though, does it?
But I think it was good. It was good,
it was so well done.
He was really, really good.
His kind of, if you know anything about Jimmy Savile, you know that's exactly what he was doing. And obviously, in this situation...
He was quite brave for the BBC.
It was, but
you sort of think, because the BBC were obviously a major part of
it. Major part of that.
And there's been such a massive paedophilia scandal in the BBC.
I just think
that's quite.
I mean, that's obviously probably why they didn't make him a paedophile, wasn't he? He was a murderer, not a paedophile.
Yeah,
murderer
instead.
So
which is better?
Better, probably. I don't know.
Who knows?
But the whole idea that we kind of just trust Sherlock that he is a murderer, I think that's what you've kind of got to. Even though he was on heroin throughout most of that episode, you go, yeah, I do believe that he's a murderer. I do believe that he's the bad guy and he's done something really, really terrible.
The whole heroin stuff kind of came out of nowhere. I know, like, it's mentioned, like, I think in the first episode where Lestrade does a drugs bust on his house.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, I'm clean.
Yeah,
and
it is brought
and
up
John
again
kind of
a few
says,
times.
It's kind of broad, but it's never really shown. I know there's the episode where he's in a crack
den when he's trying
to. It always seems like used as part of his plot device rather than part of his character.
Yeah,
like,
I mean, in the original,
we need Sherlock to be. I know original Sherlock has always been
like on opiates.
It's like House, isn't it? Yeah, he's always like a drug addict. But like, he doesn't feel like he's a drug addict all the time. He just feels like he's a drug addict when it's convenient for the storyline.
Yeah,
a drug addict rather than.
Yeah, like, oh, it'd be good to have drug addicts in this episode because you can do some weird,
do some trippy stuff.
Yeah, do some trippy stuff.
The visuals get a bit annoying this year.
Yeah, it's a little bit too much.
Too much, a lot of writing and screen. A weird like window scene where he's.
Yeah, it's a bit too much for me that. But as I was saying, we kind of trust that Sherlock knows what he's talking about, even though he's high on heroin and he's going, he's the bad guy. And then you sort of see him saying all this stuff and you're just going, how does nobody realise this guy's a bad guy? And then you think about things Jimmy Savile did and you go, kind of people didn't know that he was a bad guy, but they did kind of put it to the back of their minds that there's stories of him getting pretty much naked in the middle of like the BBC offices to get changed and stuff.
Yeah.
And basically there's this whole thing that Jimmy Savile said about like committing the perfect crime and you'd want to tell everybody, but then it wouldn't be the perfect crime because people would know.
Yeah.
So basically that he was saying that about himself, that he's that clever that, you know, he's committed the perfect crime, but he kind of wants people to know because he wants people to know that he's how clever he is. And so he started doing things to just test people and get people to try and call him out on that fact. And people just didn't do anything about it. So it's kind of cool to look at it from...
Mm.
And very brave, after, as you say, that it's not long after, really. Like, there's still shockwaves of carrying on from it now,
maybe
really.
Maybe didn't get it.
I mean, what BBC? Yeah. This Reddit man. Oh, this guy's creepy.
This
cool.
Guy's creepy, yeah. Good.
Just, oh, good God, classic, who would let this guy build a hospital?
Did you like the Euros revelation?
I don't know.
I kind of understand it though, because like
I did,
a man of his. So Sherlock has a sister that he basically erased from his memory.
Yeah,
and a man of his higher intellect with it. Okay, you believe this guy's got a mind palace, right? This guy can solve things. Like, this guy's like an inhuman control of his mind.
Yeah.
From the very first episode, this isn't a new thing. People do repress memories. That's a real medical thing. People repress traumatic memories. Like, what? People don't believe that he just forgot about this. Like, a man with that higher brain power would be able to repress a memory if he wanted to subconsciously. Because he can do fucking anything with his brain.
Yeah,
from episode one of Sherlock, that's fine. And also people have a problem with Euros, like, controlling people. So, oh, she's like an X-Man. I was like, clearly,
it's like Darren Brown.
It's not black and white. Yeah, exactly. It's not black
and
white.
We've seen it happen.
She's intelligent. She can control. She can make people. She can manipulate people. Yeah. I think we need. They're not saying she's got a superpower.
Yeah.
It's not black and white. Read into subtleties of things.
Yeah, I think
stop being so obtuse.
I think
about
it could have been done a little bit better. That I think there was one line I think that did make it sound like she had a soup that she was supernatural.
It did a little bit, but obviously you don't read into that because you're not an idiot.
But then I think it would have been really cool to actually see a full
see her
scene,
do it,
like a proper
Darren Brown.
And I don't know if that's because, you know,
don't know how to do it.
Yeah, Stephen Moffat and Matt Gaetz are incredible writers. I mean, yeah, they may go a bit too far sometimes, but they are very, very good writers. But maybe they didn't know how to write that scene. So
yeah, possibly.
Completely.
I think they do get carried away. Like we said, they do get carried away a bit with certain things and ideas and stuff. And sometimes you think you kind of wish someone was there to just be like, just kind of rein it back a little bit. Mm. But like all the ideas they have are kind of, I know, again, it's up to an arse. It's trying to be very clever. And it is quite clever in general.
Yeah, yeah,
but I feel like a lot of the stuff they're saying are often kind of metaphorical. Or kind of like higher level sort of questions of what's actually happening.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely, I think the whole
it's like the mind palace thing. It's like he's not actually got a palace in his mind. It's just saying he's got like a photogenic memory. It's not.
Yeah. And that's his way of controlling it and accessing it and stuff.
But did you like the whole thing about the dog and the dog was a kid?
I liked that because
I thought it was really cool because Redbeard's been in it since season
Do you reckon
two?
That was retroactively decided?
Yeah,
or
I think so. Yeah, because we ever heard that Sherlock's got another sibling? I feel like we've had
there's a hint.
But we think it might be a brother, I think.
I think there's a hint
There's one bit, I'm sure, and I might be completely wrong. I don't know, that makes no sense. I was like, I'm sure, but I could be wrong.
I'm 100% not 50 certain.
I'm 100% sure that I'm not 100% sure. That there is a bit where they're talking about those two, and then they say about someone else, and that there's kind of another sibling, and someone does kind of pipe up, and then they just brush it off straight away about the odd one or something like that.
Yeah, there is.
And there is something like that, I'm sure.
I like what they did, but I feel like it's like the problem with Doctor Who. I don't know if it's just because it's the same writers, but it feels like they try and continue things without a sort of plan of where it's going.
Yeah, they sort of do it and then kind of go, we'll figure out how to get out of it later on.
Yeah, it's a bit like Lost as well. It's like if you've got a plan for the third episode, then fine. But if you're just sort of saying, oh, let's just make Mary a spy and see what happens there, maybe we can tie that in later to something else. And
I think that the show is okay.
It has its flaws in that. I don't mind it so much, but I hope it doesn't
carry
on.
But they're kind of plot holes, like in your head, you can think, oh, I can make that leap.
Yeah.
I always feel like I can make that leap myself. I don't need it spelled out for me. I can kind of make it. But then again, you're watching like a really good actors with really good dialogue, funny dialogue.
Yeah.
Just interact with, that's just fun.
Yeah.
It's just fun to watch. Even when the plot holes are a bit shit and the episodes are a bit shit, the mystery's a bit shit.
Yeah.
I still like watching Benedict Cumberbatch and Martin Freeman have a chat.
I don't like it when there's an established thing, established characters and stories and whatever, and then they say, oh, there's this other bit that you just never knew that whole time, to try and introduce something new, and I feel like that's a bit lazy.
It's a bit lazy, a little bit, but
I mean, you've got to do that with TV, though, haven't you? Because obviously no one knew how successful.
They might have only done a pilot or one series. Like,
Yeah, but I feel like it shouldn't show so much. I feel like they're better than that. I was slightly disappointed in that. I like how they did it. They did it the best that they could, given the sort of story that they'd come up with.
I quite liked it, though, because I thought it's quite... I think Euros felt... I don't think they could have done that any better.
I think they did Euros better than they did Mary.
Mary was always a spy, wasn't she, from the first episode?
Yeah, but I didn't like the way that... I didn't like the way that they used her once she was a spy. I know, I wasn't sure about that.
I quite like that, because she was after Madison the whole time.
Yeah, she was.
He had information on her to blackmail her, and she was kind of after him. Isn't that why she was with John to start with?
Yeah.
Because she wanted to be close to Sherlock.
Yeah.
Yeah, but she thought
Sherlock
would
death.
I can't remember.
I can't remember.
Well, exactly.
Who knows?
I mean, well, I don't have a problem with.
What did you think of? I mean, Eurus's main motivation being she's a complete nut job.
I thought it was resolved too easily.
Yeah,
I quite like the idea that she's so psychopathic.
Yeah, I kind of wanted her to have. I kind of like the idea that it was this childhood thing of you'd never played with me, Sherlock.
But I also kind of like the idea that she's kind of got this schizophrenia kind of.
Yeah.
That's what it is. It's schizophrenia. Yeah, yeah. She's got two personalities inside. That's what it is.
I like that she was so interested.
It's
in
not
seeing...
her being like, oh, I need a hug from my brother. It's not a conscious kind of thing. It's not supposed to be taken literally. No. It's kind of a metaphor for.
I think they did wrap it up. The tests that she put them through just to see what reactions they would have, and it's like, let's see human emotion in action.
Because she's basically not a human.
Yeah, I thought that was really interesting.
I quite like that.
Especially she's been locked up since she was like, I mean, she was obviously also mental, but she's been locked up since she was six or whatever.
And it's probably, again, it's another thing of like, it's another message they're trying to say. I might read too much into this, but like mental health.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
You can't just lock people away who are mentally ill, and you've got to care for them and treat them.
And you've got to understand.
I saw a lot of comments about her being like, oh, I got a hug from Big Brother and it's all right again. I was like, that's not.
It wasn't all right because she went back to prison and she didn't speak.
Yeah, exactly. That's not the message here.
I did like the bit at the end, though, and then playing the violin and that being a way for them to.
It's such an important part for Sherlock's character.
Yeah.
To be like, oh, he can now. Like him going up to hug someone.
Yeah, yeah.
Like first episode.
He'd never have done it. He's like a.
He's grown. He's got a new friend. He's had two friends in his life.
I feel like
I really like that because it added so much more importance to him and John.
Yeah. Yeah, him and John have had like the best sort of character arc and their relationship arc. Although I do feel like some of their conflict has been a little bit stretched.
Oh, the one where Mary died was ridiculous.
Yeah, like
I didn't like any of
the conflict when there was Mary. Like I feel like people are so scared of having happy relationships that they just try and ruin them by things that are completely unnecessary.
I did really like the bit though where, in the second episode in the morgue where Sherlock had the scalpel and John had to like stop him and kind of hit him because it's a bit weak Mary for his death, but I was like, oh, it's really well. We've never seen John lose it like that before. And, you know, you kind of go, it's a bit convoluted why he would blame Sherlock, but if you just kind of go, well, if he did blame Sherlock, that's a pretty good reaction to have, really, isn't it?
I did think that Eurus was very good, the actor. She played those three different characters, and you didn't realise that they were the same person.
Yeah, no, yeah. People saying, how did Sherlock not work it out? And it's like,
because
he's not seen her as a grown woman.
Plus, he didn't meet.
I watched it.
He's never seen Eurus as a grown woman.
He didn't meet the person on the train.
Yeah, he never saw the person that was texting. Yeah. He only ever saw the therapist.
Yeah.
You just go, so he's seen one of those three people.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it was really well acted. And from somebody that went to the same youth theatre as me.
Throw that in there. Why are you not in Sherlock?
This just makes you look bad.
Yeah, because you're not in Sherlock.
It's just, testament to my hometown of Litchfield. Whoop, whoop. Although she went to the Friary.
Is this the end of Sherlock?
I mean, I thought you meant a segment.
No, it's just the end of Sherlock.
It kind of ends as if it could be the end or if it
could. I don't think they've decided yet, have they?
Obviously, Martin Freeman and Benedict Cumberbatch are a lot more famous than they were. But I would like them to go back to just solving week-by-week cases.
Yeah, I was just about to say, really I'd love to see something...
Like the early episodes.
More down to earth and just... I don't know where you could take it now.
They don't need the bigger ideas.
No, you don't.
They could just do like House is a Sherlock show.
Yeah.
And that like early seasons in that they just did week by week cases. Yeah. That was just really fun.
Yeah, House at its best was the week by week mysteries.
And then it kind of it did get very I think it just dip and then gets a bit better.
But
again.
The whole thing of like anything that they do that seems permanent, you always know that it's not going to be because they have to keep it. Like, they have to give it some longevity. And I really don't like that idea. I wish that they could do something that did make a permanent change, and yet it could carry on regardless. Yeah. I wish that they felt confident enough to do that.
House did a lot of cast changes, then brought them all back.
Yeah, exactly.
I think I'd like to see more, but at the same time, I think if they try and one-up themselves, it's...
Mm. I feel like the end is them saying, we're going to take it back to basics.
Or either we're going to take it back to basics, or we're stopping. We're done. Yeah. We're not sure yet.
So either way,
I'm glad they've left it like that, that they can easily just stop it, or they can carry it on, kind of like that.
Yeah. Agenda item number five. First ever box office quiz showdown game quiz show thing.
Sweet.
This is where, the segment where I'm going to ask you how much a film has earned this week at the box office.
Don't I'm look. Not looking.
That's going to be terrible at this.
And you're going to have to guess. Okay. Nearest to it wins a pound.
No basis of how much.
Metaphorically a pound.
Are you going to give me a quid?
Metaphorically.
Dollars yeah. or?
In dollars.
In dollars.
Sweet, okay. That's better on our exchange rate now, isn't it?
Yeah.
So this is hashtag according...
Brexit. Oh, no, wait, Trump.
No, worse.
Yeah, maybe it's
according
worse.
To boxofficemojo.com, based on the week of January the 13th till the 19th.
So this week.
Mm. So this week. Well, people might be listening to this.
Yeah, a different time. Time?
Making no sense. So I'm rounding up and down to the nearest...
Yeah.
Million or half million.
Right.
Good.
So it's at least.
So you have to guess.
Half a
Matt,
million.
You can go first.
Yeah.
La La Land. How much money has La La Land made this week at the box office?
This week.
In millions of dollars.
Oh, this is going to be really embarrassing though if we're so far off.
Well, this is why you're going to go.
I reckon about. When was it out? How long is it out for now? When did it come out? It came out on the 12th of January. So, what date are we going from here?
13th. So it's peak time.
It's peak time.
What's the highest?
13th of January it was released in the United Kingdom. I don't know when it was.
I'm going to say about 45 million.
I'm going to say, is this dollars?
Yeah. We've just had this discussion.
That makes a massive difference. 200 million.
What?
200 million?
I've no basis.
Jesus Christ.
I've no basis. What's the highest that anyone's ever got in a week?
The opening weekend for like blockbusters is like, about 85 million.
Okay.
200. Yeah, so Matt wins, obviously.
Well, I have no basis.
22 million.
Oh, was it? Oh, I thought it meant.
I was
really unsure because it's been really popular. At the moment.
22 is alright.
No, 20 for something like that is really good, but I thought
it's no 200, so.
Yeah, it's no 200 million.
Just a quick hint, none of these are above 50 million. Just,
okay.
I'm just going to say that.
Are they all indie
films?
I
need that because I have no way of.
Rogue One. How much money has Rogue One made this week?
This week.
Just as a little bit of perspective for you, no looking in the reflection behind me.
I can't see the reflection. My eyesight.
So
a
fucking rabbit out there a minute ago.
Oh, yeah.
Well, exactly.
I don't know what you're saying.
What did you say? None of them are above 50 million.
None of them are above 50. Hank goes first this time.
Oh, does she? Okay.
Yeah, because it's fairly...
5 million.
It's going to be more than that, surely. How long has it been out a while, actually, hasn't it?
Exactly.
I think it's going to have made loads. It's probably going to be about 40 million or something, but I'll go about 13 million.
You can play it tactically and just go like $5 million if you want to go higher. But still stay within...
No, don't do that. That's not fair.
I mean, it's a dick.
No, I'm not doing that.
Don't be a dick.
14 million.
2-0. 20 million.
Really?
Quite
that's
yeah. Quite, still quite a lot. It's made just as much as La La Land.
Yeah, that's bullshit, that.
Let's go for Manchester by the Sea.
10 million. Oh, no, it's you first.
If you want. 3 million. See, now she's going to alter her perspective, isn't she? It's not on anywhere.
7 million.
3-0. 2.5 million. Well,
see, that's pretty close, that, wasn't it? It's pretty close.
That's awful.
It's not getting shown anywhere. None of the majors.
So Odeon
showing it.
You've won all three, haven't you?
Yeah.
So you've won out.
I've won out.
Well, Cineworld's
showing. Do you want to get some pride back?
Yeah, okay.
Let me just see if Odeon
Hidden Figures.
Hidden Figures.
What is Hidden Figures?
Well, exactly. I thought this might throw you.
You've not heard of it.
Is this the NASA one?
Yeah, it's the NASA one. The three women.
I've only saw the trailer for the first time, but when we had seen what's called.
To be fair, yeah.
Come on.
It's black women.
Oh, black women,
so
yeah.
So isn't it going to be
four,
pretty hidden? Well, am I going first?
Three. Matt went first last time. Yeah.
Oh, okay. 5 million.
1 million.
33 million.
What? 33 million? Jesus Christ.
Boxofficemojo.com does not
lie.
Yeah,
but this is an
allegedly.
American thing. It's not even out in the UK yet, is it?
That's a lot of money for a film.
Well, I think it's total box office figures.
Okay,
that's quite impressive.
And finally, A Monster Calls.
Ooh.
Oh, Odie Nash at Manchester by the Sea. It's maybe. That aren't showing it.
Shit. Yeah. Why do you even work there?
Don't name where
I'm
I work.
Probably going to have to edit it out now, aren't I?
Just beep it.
I'm
going to beep over it. Just put a beep over it. I spend half my time.
I'll edit the bit out where we say put a beep out and then it's on cool, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are we doing? I was just about to say Monster by the Sea. Monster by the Sea.
Very different film.
25 pounds? Million. No, it's part of pounds.
25 quid?
Yeah, no, 25.
25
no, not that much.
Came out like New Year's Day.
Yeah, it did. Yeah, no, not that much.
Don't help him. I'm losing.
12.5. It's going to be really low, isn't it? It's going to be about 6 million.
Nine.
900k.
Well, really?
What? Yeah. What? Oh my god.
That's
bad.
It's a 3-2.
Yeah,
that's ridiculous.
Pulled it, back. Pulled it back.
Oh yeah, you pulled it back by
knowing a film that you didn't know.
Two consolation goals.
That's upset me. That is.
No, fun little quiz.
The reason 900K. About hidden figures so is because there was in the Golden Globes, somebody did like a speech or something, and they got hidden figures confused with Fences, which is another film.
Oh, so about black people.
Pretty much, yes. Just,
they all look the same, all these black films.
So they call them hidden fences.
Oh,
and both of the cast are just like, well, I mean, that's not even right.
Yeah,
like, but it's happened quite a few times, apparently. On Twitter, there's this whole debate going on. It's just like,
God.
That's terrible, isn't it? Anyway, sorry.
Racism. No, you can talk about your racism issues, just not your feminist issues.
Yeah, okay, yeah, cool. Fine. Yeah, that's cool.
I mean, also for time sensitive.
Yeah, also, we need to get dressed.
Go on party.
Matt does the 1-star Amazon review quiz.
Do I? Pass my computer then.
Yay!
I don't know if it's on here.
Just make one up.
What? I'm not off the top of my head.
Oh my god, that looks so on? Big and bulky now. Compared what? With that one.
What is?
How old is that?
Oh, this computer. I thought you were talking about my biceps.
It's my guns.
Oh my god! Jeez, man, that's gross. Yeah. You're like my brother-in-law.
I know, yeah. You're the one coming on to me. Calm down.
Oh dear. Bad time to take a drink.
I should spit beer everywhere.
Spit it on the imaginary rabbit.
Alright, I do have some screenshots, but I think they might be all over the place.
Shall I do an interesting trivia fact?
Yeah, you do that while I'm trying to figure this out.
Interesting trivia. We're going to skip ahead. Number. We haven't got a question of the week, so I forgot to do it. Number 8, interesting fact of the week.
Okay, hit me with it.
Emma Watson turned down the role of Mia due to scheduling conflicts with Beauty and the Beast, while Ryan Gosling turned down the role of Beast in that film to appear in La La Land.
Wow, very interesting.
It's good, isn't it? Ooh,
I don't know which I sort of respect Ryan Gosling more for that and Emma Watson less. But then also
Disney
actually,
whore.
No. But no, I really like Emma Stone as Mia. I wouldn't like Emma Watson as Mia. And I really Emma Watson as Belle. I think she's a really good cast.
I don't think Emma
for
Watson's
Belle.
Gone off kind of. Don't know.
She's done what?
Oof, sort of. You know what I mean?
That's sort of. Know what you're trying to say.
Oomph.
That's right, because you can't go in like, and like moving your fists in a really aggressive manner. And
I don't think she's got that. Fancy.
Okay.
Even when she's doing like her feminist angry speeches, I don't feel like she's all got an awful lot of power behind it.
Okay,
fair enough. Because she's a tiny woman. I mean, Emma Stone's not a big woman, but I feel like she's kind of.
She's
quite loud and charismatic, whereas Emma Watson's very quietly sort of spoken, sort of softly spoken.
When I heard that
she likes
was
reading
cast...
and stuff, doesn't she?
Well, exactly. Fucking she's perfect Belle. No, when I heard that she was cast as Belle, I was like, that is absolutely perfect casting. Whereas Ryan Gosling as Beast, I wouldn't see. I could see him playing jazz piano, because I have seen him playing jazz piano.
He looks quite similar. It's Dan jazz, Stevens, isn't it, who's playing Beast?
Who's that?
They're quite similar looking guys.
Go find it on the computer.
Except he's no Ryan Gosling. No one else is.
I love Ryan Gosling. Have you seen that thing with Ryan Gosling and Ryan Reynolds? There's all these like web pages about how they look really similar. Yeah.
I don't think they do look similar.
I don't want
They're both
really.
Called Ryan.
You know who looks really similar?
And they're quite similar, sort of comedically, sort of.
Amy Adams and Isla Fisher. They look really similar.
They're both redheads.
Yeah, but they do look really similar. But both of them have been like, well, thanks, but I don't see it.
Yeah, yeah.
We're running out of stuff to talk about here, Matt.
I know. Yeah, I mean, think I'm ready. I think I'm ready.
Okay.
Snappy quiz. Might have to forget real issues.
Snap quizzy quiz.
That's what it's called.
A snappy snap yeah, quizzy quizzy quiz.
It's a 1-star review. Amazon quiz. Okay. Film number one.
Okey-dokey.
I think Rob's winning this quiz. I've completely forgotten.
New
guys,
new
believe it or not, I don't have a spreadsheet.
Don't ruin the magic.
Yeah.
Come on. Tap.
Okay, yeah. Let's go. Right. Patients testing filth.
Silence.
Narrative heavy. Depressing.
Live by night.
Narrative. Stop shouting films out. And you're actually right.
Yes!
Right
no!
Is it Goodfellas?
Yeah.
I think, what?
narrative heavy, depressing film.
Scorsese, isn't it? Like, if someone doesn't like Scorsese, that's the problem they have with it.
This is it. Narrative heavy, depressing filth about a paranoid creep preying on troubled children in their neighbourhood so he can take advantage of free child labour to run his criminal gang.
I love it when people have moral objections to a film and think that makes it a shit film because they morally object to all the characters. So that's the point of the film.
Other people said, language filthy and unacceptable. Viewing terminated after 10 mins. They also got, there is nothing good about the fellas in this movie. In fact, they're all very bad. It should be called Bad Fellas.
Naughty boys.
And then there was one that just said, no, nasty violence, avoid.
Boring in Christians.
Yeah, and then
who gave them the internet?
But then everyone was complaining about, as you were earlier today, about turning the disc over. Like all one star reviews.
I wasn't complaining. Just saying it looked really fucking weird on my TV and couldn't be bothered.
Well, yeah, because it was like a tiny little TV in the middle of all
It's like a letterbox. Yeah, probably could have sorted it out.
Yeah,
not to be bothered.
Okay, 1-0.
Decides to fall asleep.
Oh no, I've just messed up my quiz.
It's worth it, Max. The joke was hilarious.
Yes, it was. Let me find it. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Film number two.
Yeah.
Pointless rubbish. This film did nothing for me. It was neither informative or entertaining. Just crass, vulgar, and vile. It has no real plot, no beginning, middle, or end. Just a group of disgusting junkies doing disgusting.
Trainspotting.
Who would I give that to there?
I've got the audio.
It was pretty close, that one, I have to say.
I feel like you edged it, but I had it on the tip of my... I had it in my head before I said it out loud.
Well done, guys. You're doing very well today. There was also one that said, they spot literally no trains. I was sitting down... with my conductor's hat whistling official Scottish train spotting manual 1996, expecting a wild ride and instead learnt about drugs. Spoiler alert, don't do drugs, kids. Spot trains instead. And then there's someone that went real off, like a proper real off the rails going, as someone from Edinburgh who lived and went to plenty of the places mentioned in Trainspotting, I have to say, read the book, and the book instead, which has the full content and message, rather than just a comic shorthand for what was happening at the time, and, you know, getting really upset about it. I've got loads for this other one. I don't know which one. Oh, I've got like a million different films there. I don't know which one I'm going to read.
Dead air.
Yeah, just edit this out.
It's fine, I love editing. It's my favourite thing. I just love sitting at home. I'll just Google some Facebook or something. Google some Facebook. That's what I said.
Oh, here we go. Okay, right. Ready? You ready?
Yeah.
Getting some social media attention right here.
It's a pity the whole human race wasn't... Oh, sorry, I should read the title. Will the title give it away? The title for the review is, the whole human race is participating with them in the agony of their return. It's a pity the whole human race wasn't participating in the agony of the tens of thousands of Vietnamese men, women and children the USA were killing around the same period instead of focusing on the fate of just three human beings. More Hollywood pulp. So move on to the next one?
Yeah.
The disclaimer buried deep in the closing credits, blink and you'll miss it, hardly inspires confidence. This film is based on a true story. However, certain characters and events have been fictionalised for dramatic purposes. Of course, the problem is, we're not told which characters and events, or even how much of the film has been fabricated. 5%, 50%, 90%? For instance, much of the onboard action is pure invention. Most of the scenes involving the Lovell family were either complete fiction or didn't occur in the same way shown in the film. Worst of all, though, is the way that the director devotes much of the latter part of the film to original astronaut Ken Mattingly working alone and the power-up procedure. This is complete nonsense. It never happened. In reality, a small army of scientists and technicians worked on the problem. Even if you're prepared to put the historical accuracy to one side, the film is a badly made film. As is his custom, instead of letting the events speak for themselves, and they should hardly be more dramatic than this story, Howard uses very cheap film school gimmick in the book to artificially ramp up the tension. In short, whether you're looking for historical accuracy or just a well-told yarn, you will be disappointed.
I thought I knew this wasn't the space astronaut thing.
You're not sure what it is?
Apollo 13.
Yeah.
Oh.
Who's the director?
Ron Howard.
Ron Howard.
Ron Howard, yeah.
That's what...
I'll read the last one.
What was the Vietnamese?
Oh, no, because it was around the same time, wasn't it?
Oh, right. That's what threw me off, because
it was a line from...
I was thinking of a war film.
Yeah. Like, no, that's really? It. Well, no, because there's a line in the film that says the whole human race is participating with them in the agony of their return, which I think is what like a newsreader said at the time of Apollo 13. And then someone's just gone off the rails and gone... More Hollywood pulp. You just think the film's not about the Vietnam War. The film's that was the point. The film's not about the Vietnam War. The film's about the Apollo 13 astronauts. 3-0,
yeah,
Rob.
All right.
3-0.
Come on.
Is that the end of the quiz?
That's the end of the one-star quiz. Hope you enjoyed it, Paul.
The pop, pop, pop quiz.
Lots of little fads today, aren't we?
Yeah, it's been good.
Do you want to do real issues very quickly?
Yeah, real issues.
Maybe. Yeah.
We'll do a 5-minute real issues.
Yeah, let's do it.
This is the revived segment that we did once. Yeah. Well, I did once, I think.
You should get angry at
something. We can all just get a little bit angry about something that's annoyed us to do with popular culture.
It's good that you schedule your anger like this.
It's very therapeutic.
Yeah, it's very good.
Better than killing people, isn't it?
Yeah.
Better than killing children and throwing them in the river.
I mean, I have to know with you, so bag. I'm happy with this outlet.
I think we all agree that Matt liked Rogue One a bit more than we did.
Yeah.
But it's not fantastic.
No, it's better than the other prequels.
I mean, I give it 3 stars in my review.
Yeah. It's better than all the other prequels.
Three stars is fair, isn't it?
Yeah.
For a film with zero character backstory or development.
Yeah, I'd give it a good solid 3 stars.
And a very straightforward plot where you know exactly what's going to happen.
And so much in-depth theorising about the plugging in of a communications cable.
That was slightly better second time reviewing, actually.
Oh, is it?
It did kind of work a little bit
really
better second time.
A little bit more sense.
Do you see a film second time, you think, I'm sure they've edited this differently this time.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Don't pay attention.
Yeah, maybe. Because talking kept throwing me out. But I think you're probably not annoyed about this, but me and Matt are, because we're...
Nerds.
You know, on the internet, reading all the comments sections, trolling people.
I'm ready to be underwhelmed by what you're mad at.
The hype around Rogue One.
Right.
The amount of people who love this film, I say it's the best Star Wars film since the
Empire.
Even people say it's better, it's as good as, it's the best Star Wars film, it's the best one since A New Hope.
The absolute worst.
And people saying
it's IGN.
IGN saying it was their film of the year for 2016.
What? IGN said that?
Yeah.
How many films, they watch one, if they watch that, Suicide Squad and Batman v Superman, fine.
Yeah.
No, cause, IGN.
Yeah, out of the three of them.
That's the best film I've ever seen.
As a film.
Then
I'll prefer to watch, but yeah.
I'd probably prefer to
watch Batman v Superman.
Yeah, I would as well. It's probably technically a worse film.
Yeah.
But there's something kind of interesting about it.
They're trying to do something more with it.
Ben Affleck's created some character. Whether the characters are flawed or not, at least he's tried to create a character.
How have you not watched, you know, Arrival, Hunt for the World of People, Captain Fantastic,
The Nice Guys, Spotlight, Big Short,
Everybody Wants Some? And you just think, what have you watched?
Yeah.
Like, what have you been watching this year, IGN?
And
IGN is a whole
thing. It makes sense now because the US people are just, they just hire anyone who's got a bit of generic American charisma.
I usually agree with what the IGN UK people
agree with the IGN UK people.
Are really good.
Yeah.
The American team are just
idiots.
Even the
IGN UK team think that the IGN American team are idiots.
You can kind of tell a little bit as well.
And you can tell how smug they are that their Let's Play series is the most successful IGN series ever.
Yeah.
And it's just three guys pissing about.
Yeah.
And I bet all the others are so angry.
Because they're not taking it seriously. They just take everything so...
Do you remember that thing where they're unpacking some toys and they get so excited about these lightsabers, the American guys?
And
we had to switch off because like, this isn't interesting. It's not informative. It's just like fanboys going,
horrible.
And it's not fun to watch.
Fuck off, American. Yeah. Unless you're listening, you're American, we love you.
Yeah. If you're part of the IGN team.
You did Trump's.
Yeah. Share us. Thanks.
Yeah. Give us a share. Yeah. That's what's annoyed us.
Yeah, people just love it.
It's made me
hate
the film more because I kind of feel like I need to balance it out.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, if everyone's like, this film's all right, it's fine, I'd be like, it is fine, it's fine. But then I think because people love it,
you have to explain to them why they're wrong.
I need to kind of drag it down to get it average where it should be.
It just doesn't make sense because me and my friends all came out and went, I enjoyed that, but it's got a lot of problems. We spoke about all the problems and everything.
I think the main problem
then
is
met with
a bit
people
boring.
And spoke about the problems, but then
speak to Paul.
Scathing. Despises it. But but like just seeing people online hyping about it, and I just think, what's wrong with you?
Mitchell.
Yeah.
Like, what's the people whose opinions I trust all hated it.
I don't get it. Because I've seen... I don't know if I've seen proper Star Wars fans like it or not.
I don't think I have.
I don't know whether it's like Star Wars
fans haven't liked it.
I've seen people who
claim casual Star Wars fans, like my level of Star Wars fan.
I've seen people who, or less. I mean, you don't. I mean, who are you to tell someone that they are or aren't a fan?
Well, no, exactly. Properly. You don't want to be that guy. That's not.
You're not a proper Star Wars fan. But I always really like Star Wars, but I've never said I'm like a massive geek. But then I think I've watched them all. I play all the games. Got the Lego. I probably am a bigger Star Wars fan than most people.
No, yeah, I'd say I probably am. Yeah,
but.
But then there are people that watch it and see all of those really unsubtle Easter eggs and go, oh, yeah, I understand that.
The good litmus test is, do you watch the prequels or do you just pretend they don't exist? That's kind of my, of how much of a Star Wars fan you are. Even when you're like our generation, the prequels are our films.
Yeah, but it's bad. Yeah, but
I like them probably as a kid.
Do you cry every time you see sand because it just reminds you of that
scene? Did you see that thing about why Darth Vader wasn't on the beaches? Yeah, because it doesn't like the sand.
Yeah, sand is... Yeah. So we're annoyed at that.
I'm very annoyed at that. Yeah.
I don't know why it shouldn't annoy me as much as it does, but it just kind of does because
if anyone out there really loves Rogue One,
let's know.
Like write something. Just tell us why you really haven't heard anyone. Do you know? Give a genuine reason why. And I've heard
just being like, the action's awesome. Yeah. Because
I've heard people that hate the film a lot more than I have. Like mainly Paul.
I mean,
and things that he said, I've just gone. I do agree with that, but it didn't bother me as much as it bothered
you. Yeah, no,
whereas
no one
I've not heard anyone say, I loved it because of this reason. I've gone, actually, yeah, I do see that.
Yeah.
But I've seen reasons why people hate it. I don't necessarily feel that strongly about it, but I get why they hate it.
Yeah. The only reason I've seen that people have said, I think it's quite a brave move because they killed off everybody.
I don't think that's brave, though. I think that's lazy.
It's just an easy way out.
I think it's lazy writing.
It depends which angle you're coming from. Because as a Star Wars fan, it's not brave. But as a non-Star Wars fan that just goes and sees an action film and then everybody dies at the end.
It's just a clean
slate.
That's
a really good, clever way of ending a film.
It's not.
If you're not a Star Wars fan, if you don't see it in the wild.
People keep saying, like, even the Empire podcast, like, this was really brave. Like, it's not brave. Storytelling, it's lazy writing just to say, oh, blank slate.
Well,
it's lazy. Well, yeah, it's really lazy.
But you're thinking about it in the context of all of the Star Wars
films. What it is. It's in context of it. But it's not a standalone film. This exists.
Well, no,
this,
but the only reason this exists. Only seen it as a standalone film.
No, they haven't.
No one
has seen that as only a Star Wars film.
I know quite a few people that have never watched any of the Star Wars films. You know, the guy that moved in our bed. He was like, I've not watched any of the.
That sounded really
films.
Weird, like someone had got in your bed.
Like, the guy who's in our bed, that's.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, no, you like, you brought it in from
the
van.
The guy you killed.
It was just Saturday night.
Do you remember when you killed that guy who crept into our bed?
No, he was like, who's the Star Wars fan? And I was like, well, I mean, I am, because it's in my house, these posters. I mean, what kind of question is that? Yeah. Anyway, like.
Is your boyfriend a nerd?
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty
much.
He's not
a real man like me who carries furniture around.
Yeah. Well, he didn't even carry it all up the stairs. I had to carry half of it up the stairs anyway.
But,
hey, I did one whole thing.
Who's the real man?
Right. Me, obviously. But he was like, I've not watched any of them. So I'm going to watch the new one. I was like, oh, okay.
Get a life.
Well,
mask,
I mean,
on.
It, you know, it happens.
It's not going to be a plug for Fortnite for him.
Oh, we'll
the
do
missus
it for
is
him.
Calling. Whoopa! He's not going to notice this happening, is he?
No. He'll never know.
No, telling where she was.
Oh.
She's driving, so she rang me. She said she was going to be here at like 6.
999. Call the police.
No, she's ringing and driving. She's got Bluetooth.
Oh, she's got Bluetooth.
That's what I mean. That's why she couldn't text. That's why she rang, because she has Bluetooth. Fair enough.
It's fine, then.
We don't like Rogue One.
It's fine, but I like it less because people love it.
Yeah, it winds me up that people love it so much.
What kind of annoys me is when people talk about the fan service, like people saying the fan service is great in it. I thought it was fucking. That was the worst thing about this film.
It's because it's not to you; it's to casual
fans. But it should
be.
But the Force
Awakens should be to you. I know.
Fan service, like the whole film, should not be based on fan service. That's what people keep saying. The positive point of this film is the fan service is really good. It's like watching New Hope again. Well, then watch A New Hope again.
Yeah.
No, if you're not watching New Hope again, watch The Force
Awakens. You don't need a whole film just
vomiting
out the same stuff again, but with slightly better CGI.
Was it better CGI or was it awful?
The effects in the final third were really good.
Yeah,
okay.
And the action was really good.
The action was good, but I didn't care. Like, action for me, like, I don't care if it's well choreographed. Like, the fight between like Luke and Vader in Empire is not choreographed particularly brilliantly or shot,
but it's emotionally powerful.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why it's a good scene.
But then it's like fight scenes in general. I sort of tune out for those. It's like a dance scene. It's like, it's pretty to watch. And then,
but
you know,
if,
it doesn't affect anything
until it's
finished.
But in La La Land, it does make a difference. That's why La La Land's good.
It finishes and then it's over.
But the whole point of the song and dance in La La Land is that's the development of the relationship.
Yeah.
okay. And it's pretty conflict, to watch.
And the yeah, but it's a development. Well, no,
it's
talking about
it's brilliant, actually, because the first dance scene in La La
Land... Is that them forming a connection?
Them forming a connection, but they don't touch each other in that dance. Yeah. Like, yeah. They're dancing together, but they don't have a physical
it's
connection.
Nonsense.
And then in their second dance together, they're
fight
dancing,
scenes,
like, in hold. So it's like
yeah, fight exactly, scenes yeah. and dance scenes are the exact same thing for me.
Yeah, but they tell a story.
They tell a story, but they're... Well, fight scenes tell less of a story, then.
No, they do.
Yeah.
No,
they...
Yeah. Well, they do, yeah.
Yeah.
What do they?
Yeah, well, it
like Luke and Vader. Luke and Vader in the end of Jedi is a.
Yeah.
Is that their whole relationship?
That's the dialogue
coming to,
yeah. in between the fighting.
But that's in the yeah. fight. That
the
emotion
whole, like,
on. There's a reason.
Yeah, but the emotion
to...
on Luke's face when he's like chopping off his arm,
yeah.
like that aggressive nature a... tells a lot about his character and what his character's
action,
going
yeah.
through, and it's done that through action. Yeah.
There's
action,
a...
not fight scene. Fight scene is like you pan around.
Well, no, that's
my.
You're talking about Michael Bay. You're not talking.
Yeah, I'm talking about.
Well, that's it, isn't it? Like you kind of go fight scenes where. There's a reason for them to be fighting. That's cool. It's at the end of Rogue One. I just go, well, why's the whole Rebel Alliance gone there? That should be a covert operation.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
That should be really low-key
yeah.
action. But you've turned it into a spectacle for no reason. And yeah, it's really cool, but...
And that's all added as well, apparently.
Yeah,
yeah.
But I don't like any of that. I don't care about any of that because
yeah, exactly.
I've not been with any... Like, I know you. Like, some people don't like the characters in it, but I'm like, at least the people on the ground I've spent the film with, whether
yeah,
they're fleshed out
yeah,
fully
yeah.
or not. The guys in the
yeah.
ships, I'm just like...
Rogue Five's dead. Oh, great, that's an Easter
cool.
egg.
Yeah, but,
I
which
know
was kind of like
die,
a nine. Like,
yeah,
once
yeah,
like that, I didn't mind.
They were
I just
fine,
sort
yeah.
of went,
yeah.
That's kind of a little cool.
That's
moment,
something that
but...
I might not have picked up on
yeah.
as a casual fan.
See, I didn't the first time I watched it, actually.
I not, didn't.
Yeah, I didn't, actually. Until someone said to me, oh, did
yeah,
you hear that? And I went, oh, no, I missed that. And not because I didn't hear it. Not because I'd. Do you know, if I heard Rogue Five, I'd be like, oh, yeah, that's what that is. I just didn't hear it because it was in the chaos of battle, obviously. But...
The chaos of battle.
Yeah. That's
you
why I'm
the
writer.
Chaos battle.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's it. It's the podcast.
That's the podcast. We could do a 10th point, but we don't have any feedback, so...
And we've got to go.
And we've
yeah.
got to go.
Plug stuff, Matt.
Go.
RealFilm_movies on Twitter.
I thought you were going to do your.
That's
nice. We're not recording anything recently, so... You can go and check out the Fortnightly Forum podcast on Twitter and SoundCloud and iTunes as well, but we've not recorded anything recently,
so
but we will be... Yeah, I know, but we've all been busy. It's been
Fair
Christmas.
Enough.
We're
that's
all partying.
True.
There'll
true.
Be something up next week.
We're all drunk.
realfilmmovieviews.wordpress.com.
At some point, we'll have Grow Some Ovaries.
I mean, we're still on Real Film.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Real Film. YouTube channel.
YouTube channel.
Link it below some Let's Plays.
Yeah
I'm going to be doing some videos on there, which is going to be cool. I'm going to do
Saints for a long time.
Rewrite of Rogue One. I'm going to do some reviews of Titanfall 2 and Dishonored 2. And what else was I going to do? I was going to do another video, but I can't remember.
Yeah, get on our YouTube channel, subscribe.
Because yeah, there's going to be some stuff on there.
All the podcasts are going as well now for people who don't like SoundCloud or iTunes.
Yeah.
That's it. And on Facebook, give us a like. Share it around. That's the main thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we're on Patreon.
Give us money.
Give us some money.
Or beers.
Or Master Brewers Collection. Definitely going to tweet you.
Yeah.
If you want to listen to this, send us a crate of beers and we'll just
drink.
We'll plug you every episode.
Yeah, we'll just say.
We'll have a few beers.
I'm liking this beer.
I mean, these have been very nice. I'm now on the Bottle of Britain Spitfire Premium Kentish Ale.
I'm on Spitfire Gold.
It's very nice.
It's a golden ale.
They're going down very nicely.
Yeah. Too nicely.
Yeah. Maybe send us another crate.
Yeah. We've only got two left. We've got a whole night of partying ahead of us.
And also, our feminist podcast is due to be edited. We've recorded it now. So it's me and Lowry and Bethan.
I mean, names are kind of relevant, aren't they?
It's not relevant.
Me
names
these,
aren't relevant.
Me and these people.
We're doing it themed by month, so January is diet month, because New Year, New You. So, take
new,
a listen.
New Year, New Me. So
yeah.
New
yeah. Don't just walk around going,
New
Year, New
You. Fucking change your life. I'm not changing. You change your life.
Perfect.
Okay, you're literally describing every female magazine this month.
Exactly. That's the problem. Sorry.
I'm doing satire.
Yeah.
Can you There's no animals in it.
Can you not see Rob's come as cosmopolitan today?
But yeah, when we've
knowledge.
Got that up, then, watch it, read it, watch
listen
it,
to
listen,
it.
To,
listen
it.
To it.
I found it in the end. Yeah.
Yeah.
Got there in three.
Okay,
bye everyone.
Thanks for listening. Bye.
Bye.
See you next,
bye.
Next
bye.
Week where we'll talk about something else that we don't know about yet because we've not decided, but it'll be something.
It'll be something super cool.
Okay, bye.
I've broken the seal. I need a wee.
Yeah, I need a wee.
I pissed on the table. Right.